Proverbs 31 says to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. And Compassion International exists to do just that. To be an advocate for children, to release them from poverty, and to enable them to become responsible and fulfilled Christian adults. It's our mission to counter their feelings of worthlessness and insufficiency with the love and truth of God's Word, and to show children that with Christ, they don't just have a future, but they have hope.
From Ecuador. He's here with his beautiful wife and daughter, and he has gone through the program, and him and his wife are going into the mission field in Paraguay to be church planters. So we are just so excited to have him with us today. So I want you guys to give him a great warm welcome as he speaks.
Good morning. My name is Darío Guerrero. I was born in Ecuador, in the jungles of Ecuador, where it rains a lot and it's very, very humid. Our house, where I lived, where I grew up in, was the size of a room, your room. There was a bed where my mom and dad slept on, and us kids slept on the floor, on the dirt floor. The house had a tin roof. Unfortunately, it had a few holes in it. So when it rained, you can imagine the rain coming in, get us wet. The walls were made out of plywood, very thin type of wood that you had to change if we have money, which sometimes we didn't have, every so often because the rain really damaged the wood. In that same room, in the corner, there was a refrigerator. I did not like looking at it. I did not like to even approach it. But once in a while, I would venture myself to open it. But every time I did that, I was so, so disappointed. Laid down. What I found there was not fruit or vegetables or milk or eggs, nothing that you would find in a refrigerator. But you may take it for granted sometimes. All I found was beer in the freezer and the fridge. My dad was an alcoholic. The alcohol made him a very responsible person, abusive, not loving at all. I remember one night I was sleeping and I heard screams outside, and I said, what's that? It woke me up, so I rushed out, and I saw my dad beating my mom, pounding at her like crazy. And I was about 7 years old. I tried to help her out, but it was to no avail. He just swung his hand at me. He told me to go back to bed. This happened almost every single weekend. I was getting tired of this. I was afraid of him. One night, it was raining too, very, very hard. He was a carpenter, he was packing his stuff. And I asked him, Dad, where are you going? And I said, I'm leaving you. And I said, what? What do you mean? Like, what does it mean? He's like, I'm leaving you forever. I'm not coming home. My world just crumbled right there in front of him. And I picture myself, what's going to happen without my dad? I know he was irresponsible, abusive dad, but he still was my dad. He left. My mom came home that night after working so many jobs that day. And she asked, where is he? And I said, he's gone. He left us. Mom said, okay, go to bed. We'll talk about it tomorrow. And talk we did. She told me, since he left, now you have to have become the man of the house and you have to go find a job. I was like, a job? What does that even mean? I don't have any skills. What am I gonna do? I'm just a 7-year-old boy looking for a job. I wanna go to school, Mom. There were other kids in our neighborhood that were given that opportunity, but I didn't have that. My first job was to sell newspaper. That was all right. The second job was to work at a sawmill. You know what a sawmill is? There were big pieces of wood that I had to roll, sometimes carry if I was able to. They were heavier than me. Hold them onto a machine so that machine will cut it. Many times, I escaped from losing my life. It was a very dangerous job. That didn't provide enough money to buy food for my family or send them to school. So my mom said, you have to work another job. So in the afternoons, I would go down the river and I would pick up rocks, put them in a wheelbarrow and take them to a construction site. Day in and day out, doing the same thing. I got tired of doing that, but I had to do it. If I stopped, wouldn't have nothing to eat. But all the money I made was not even enough, but it was something. You know what? Poverty, this is what it does, and this is what it tells you. Poverty forced me to work. Don't get me wrong, I don't think work is a bad thing, but child labor. How many of you know of someone who's 7 years old, boy or girl? Imagine that person, that little soul right there, having to go to work, skip a school, so he or she can provide for a family. Food, clothes, basic needs that every child, from no matter where that child is from, should be given. I lack those things, those very things that help a child develop well, emotionally, psychologically. We were malnourished. I was being mocked, laughed at by other kids who were going to school when they saw me working. I had a very low self-esteem. I was ashamed of myself. I said, is this bad? I'm not working? Poverty taught me that I don't matter to anyone. It was like a vicious circle. It was telling me, you were born in this life, right here, where you are, and there's no way out. I was trapped. I was without hope. I don't think I'd even had dreams. All I know is that I didn't know what the future would hold. At night, I would go to bed hungry on top of that, but very worried and concerned. What's going to happen next day? What if I get kicked out of my job because I'm too small and I don't work as fast as other guys? I don't think a child should worry about it. Children in this country, they don't think twice about where food is coming because they trust mom and dad will work. My case was different. My mom, being a believer at that time that I didn't know, she told us to, okay, we're going to pray around the bed we have. Every single night, I'm telling you, she had us kneel down and pray to God. I didn't know who this God was. I have no idea. And I said, why are you saying that he's good? Where is he? Has he shown up? Haven't seen him. This is what children do. They see black or white. They want to see something tangible. And I was seeing none of that. I realized that I was being defined by poverty. Huge, the lies I was believing in. For a year we pray. Something happens when you pray. Amazing things happen when the God of heaven hears you talking to him. We will pray that God will return my dad home. We will pray that God, we want to have an education, we want to go to school. Provide shoes for us, clothes, those very things we need. In the midst of this, of praying to this God I had no idea existed, my sister and I were invited to church, and about 120 kids went that day, and the pastor was talking about the compassion program. And he looked at me, and I remember looking at me. He says, "You, Darío, have been chosen." And I was like, "Me, chosen? For what? I've never been chosen. No one has ever noticed me. No one has ever noticed, called my name, for that matter." He says, "Someone in the United States wants to be your friend." My friend? What does it even mean? They would send letters to me. I did not have a writer at that time. Someone read it for me. The truth is, they told me, spoke volumes to my life. They told me, "You are not forgotten. You matter to God. You are important. The creator of the universe knows what you're going through. He will define who you are." Wow! I couldn't believe what I was hearing. I said, "Come again? Can you read that again?" Seriously, I kept those letters for a long, long time. This much of letters they sent me over the years. And the pictures, I kept them until they were faded, like faded out, really, because the humidity damaged the photos. That's how much those letters mattered to me. They impacted my life. They spoke truth into me and made me realize that, wow, I'm not alone in this world. And poverty does not have a grip on my life. 6 months after I was into the program, I came to know a very different type of relationship between a father and a son. God became my father. I came to believe that he really loves me and that he will make a way through what I'm going through in this life right now. You see, my sponsors play a very important role telling me that I'm loved by God and he's going to take care of me. Boom, baby. God keeps his promise, and he has never stopped being the dearest dad a child could ever have, the Heavenly Father. Compassion International in the local church spoke truth into my life. It was as if poverty was not really what I'm trying to focus on now, is on the basic needs per se. It was deeper than that. I was living in a spiritual world that was dark. And God rescued me and brought me into his kingdom of light. And out of that came the basic things I needed, because God takes care of his children, believe it or not. I am a product of the compassion program. And these folks, this pays off. I'm flesh and blood, from experience speaking, that there are children in El Salvador who are waiting to be sponsored. I'm not selling you a packet. I'm giving you an opportunity to you today to be this channel of blessing in the life of a boy or a girl who, years down the road, you have supported a child who become the next president of the Republic of their country, minister, doctor, laborer, farmer, librarian, not to a profession, but who have Christ in their heart. You will help them be released from poverty in Jesus' name. That's what makes the difference here. My wife and I, as Pastor's wife said, we're going to South America to be missionaries to a people group who has no concept of God, no idea who he is. the same things I had when I was a child. We're going to give back. Had I known God when I was a child, it wouldn't be very difficult to understand that He really is real. My sponsors changed my life forever, eternally, through Compassion International. You can be part of that too, and you won't regret it. You'll be changed in the process. So thank you very much for your time. God bless you.
What a powerful story of life change. And this is Compassion Weekend, and I was telling the team before service last night that this is probably my favorite weekend of the year. It really is. Pastors are peculiar people. They get excited about the things I don't think God gets very excited about sometimes. We go to pastors' conferences, pastors' retreats, pastors' conventions, pastors' whatever, meetings, and so on and so forth, and we talk about how many people are coming. How many people are coming to your church? How many people come to your church? Oh, this is how many people come to my church. Let me tell you about how many people are coming to your church. Let me ask you first, so that when you tell me your number, I'll add 100 to my number. And pastors oftentimes are guilty of missing the main thing. The Bible never tells us to go to church. The Bible never tells us to go to church. Isn't that crazy? For some reason, we've fallen in love with this idea of people going to church. Go to church. How many people are you getting to go to church? So pastors get excited about weekends that I don't think really make headlines in heaven. Like, they get excited about Christmas Eve because on Christmas Eve, people, a lot of people are gonna go to church. And they get excited about Easter Sunday because that's the Super Bowl of going to church. Or even Mother's Day, the third highest attendance weekend on average in America, because all the guilty sons go to church for mom. And we get so excited about the things I don't think heaven gets excited about. I think that heaven gets excited when we don't just go to church, but when we are the church. And that's what Compassion Weekend is about. That's why it's my favorite weekend of the year, because today you have a wonderful opportunity. We all have a wonderful opportunity today to be the church, not just go, not just attend a service in a comfortable building with a wonderful atmosphere and a coffee cafe with free coffee, but to do the things that Jesus has called us to do. And to be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ in a world that desperately needs to know that there is hope in this world, and the name of that hope is Jesus. And we're His hands, we're His feet. So I want to close the service today with a very short message, and I want to read from a passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 9 and then take a look at what compassion calls us to do. Would you stand together with me as we read God's word? Here's what it says, Matthew 9, 35. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news or the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When He saw the crowds, He had compassion. Somebody say compassion. When He saw the crowds, He had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then He said to His disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into His harvest field. In verse 1 of chapter 10, it says, and He called to Him His 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. In the name of the apostles are these, and it lists all the names there. And let's skip ahead here to verse 5, here's what it says. These 12 Jesus sent out. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go. I'm skipping ahead, it says, go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Go heal the sick. Go raise the dead. Go cleanse lepers. Go cast out demons. You received without paying. Go give. Without pay. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Today I pray in this hearing of your word that our hearts will be changed and renewed. May the entrance of your word bring understanding to our minds. May we see as Jesus sees and feel as Jesus feels and pray as Jesus prays and give as Jesus gives. May your kingdom come in a powerful way. And may the results of this weekend be like ripples in a pond that spread further and farther than we ever imagined, because someone in this building decided to give and to do and to be the church. May we see Jesus in him only. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Amen. Have a seat. Four things that compassion calls us to do. If you're taking notes, fill in the blanks. If you're not taking notes, fill in the blanks. Number one, open your eyes to see what Jesus sees. Open your eyes to see what Jesus sees. When you look at people, what do you see? When you open your eyes in your daily life, what do you see? When you turn on the television, what do you see? I almost hesitate to ask that question in the heat of an election season. What do you see? Do you know why I have to come to church? Do you know why? Other than the fact that I'm paid to be here. But ask my wife, even on vacation, I have to go to church. I have to. Here's why. It's a phrase I want you to repeat after me in just a moment. Don't say it just yet, but here's the phrase. Because the vortex is real. The vortex is real. Okay, so now say it with me. One, two, three. The vortex is real. All right, say it alone now. One, two, three. Okay, good, now you got it. What am I talking about? I'm talking about when you walk out these doors or when you shut off your computer or television, those of you watching online, you're gonna get sucked into the vortex again. The vortex of American crazy. Election crazy. Selfie crazy. Facebook, social media, crazy, right? Bottom line, I'm running my business. What's the bottom line? Crazy. And how many know that this culture and this world, there's a vortex to it, and the vortex is real, and we'll walk out these doors today, and literally we'll feel the of Americanism, which is not Christianity. Okay? Resolve now to realize that your country is far away from Christianity. Our country is more self-absorbed than ever before. Our world is more inward focused. Me, 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 me. The greatest threat to Christianity is not Islam or Hinduism. The greatest threat to Christianity is meism. It's all about me. I read an article this week that there is this phone that Samsung just came out with, and there's a setting on the reverse camera of the phone for when you take a selfie, and the setting automatically retouches your photo as soon as you take it. Automatically airbrushes out your zits and pimples and freckles. Automatically makes you look better than you really do. And we are in an obsessed culture with doing that in every way imaginable. Like some of you are selfie crazy. Your theme in life is me, my selfie, and I. Everything you're doing is like, oh, here I am in the bathroom, selfie. Like, I don't want to see that. Here I am picking pumpkins with my honey, selfie. Your honey's nowhere to be found in the picture. It's just you. Just you. You and your duck face. Like, what's up with this? When do you ever do this? Stop it. It's ugly. We don't want to see it. Our cell phones are sucking us into the vortex. If Hillary gets elected, all hell's going to break loose. Vortex. If Donald Trump gets elected, all hell's gonna break loose. Vortex. I mean, it's like the vortex is real. How many know what I'm talking about? It's waiting for you out there. This is why I have to come to church. Because this is a break from the vortex. To say, stop. Stop thinking about you. Be the church that bears the name of Jesus, who left heaven, left the glories of heaven, and took on the form of a servant and became obedient to the Father and lived in poverty for you. He who did not need a thing, had everything, surrendered all things for you. And if you're going to be a Christian, if you're going to be a Christian, you start becoming like the Christ you claim to serve. That's what Christianity is. Christianity is not find the church that fits me. Christianity is not come and sit and listen to the preacher yell at me for 40 minutes. Come to church. It's not, I need a church where I feel the worship fits my needs and the children's church fits my needs and the preacher fits my needs. I need to find a church where I get fed. All right, listen. Some of you have been Christians for like 40 years. You have been a spiritual person in Christ for 40 years. At some point in the natural, you learn to feed yourself. So too in the spiritual, right? Like so too in the spiritual. My daughter is going to formals now. She's 15. She's going to formals. I remember when I was feeding her pureed carrots. Do you know why I did that? Because she couldn't do it. She was like 2 months old. How strange would it be if I accompanied her to her formal and in front of her date, I was like, here you go, honey. I know you still need to be fed. I mean, as much as I would love to do that in front of her boyfriend, just like, she doesn't have a boyfriend. She's not allowed to have one until she graduates law school. But that's, you know, you know what? That's what I would, right? How ridiculous would that be? That's exactly what a Christian who says, I need a church that feeds me looks like in the gateway of heaven. At some point, it's not about you anymore. Stop getting sucked into the vortex of Christianity. And see what Jesus sees, which is someone other than you. Matthew 9:36, when he saw the crowds, what? He had compassion. Because he saw they were harassed. They were helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. If you're taking notes, write this down. Here's a fact for you today. People are hurting more than you think. People are hurting more than you think. When you see people, what do you see? Too many of us see objects to serve our end goal for our lives. Well, let me hang out with these people because they can really like get me into the in crowd. We do that in high school, and then we carry that right into the business world and right into the financial world and right into our married world and right into our moms with preschoolers world and teenagers world, and let me get into the neighborhood where I can really be, I can feel significant. It's a vortex. And God says, I thought of you. Pass it on. See what Jesus is. People are hurting more than you think. When we were getting financing for this building, we had a banker from Missouri, and this bank is in Missouri with that our loan is with, and they're a Christian, kind of like really Christian kind of bank that lends to churches like ours all across the country, and this guy would come up and check on the progress. This guy from Missouri would come up and check on the progress, and he was a very devout Christian from the Bible Belt. And so he would take us to lunch after he came and visited the property. He said, don't worry about it, guys, I'm paying. But when it's your banker telling you that he's paying, how many know it's really you paying? Right, so thank you. So he would take us out. And he's a Bible Belt Christian. Loved the guy. Awesome guy. But he would do this total Bible Belt move while we were having dinner. And he would stop the waitress as she took our orders, and he would say, "Hey, we're all a bunch of Christians here, and we don't want you just to serve our food. We want to care for you, and so but we're going to pray for our food in a few moments. Would you have anything on your heart? Is there anything going on in your life we can pray for you about?" And you know, when you're a New England Christian, you know, that's kind of like, hey, that's weird. Oh, no, this is New England. We're the frozen chosen, okay? Just no. Take that back to Missouri. Right? That's, you know, that's like a little bit of me, a little fraction of me had that thought. And every time he did it, not a single time did the waitress say, "No, I'm good." She had a problem, a major problem. The last time that he was here, we went out to a restaurant in the area and said that to her, and she said, "Yes, can you pray for me? Because tonight, after my shift, I have to drive to Providence. I have to see my son at college, and I have to take away his car keys because I just found out that he's selling drugs. And I don't know what I'm going to do, and I need help." People are hurting more than you think. And the gospel calls us to see someone other than us. To get out of the vortex. That's what this moment is about. It is time out with getting your business going in the right direction. Time out with your social media profile. Time out with educating yourself, with promoting yourself, with advancing yourself, with using other people to get yourself where you want. Time out. 2,000 years ago, God said an eternal time out. I'm entering into history to change your life. Because when I see you, I see people who are harassed and helpless and need a shepherd. And that shepherd's name is Jesus. See what Jesus sees. Number two, if you're taking notes, open your heart to feel what Jesus feels. Open your heart to feel what Jesus feels. That Jesus doesn't just see us, he feels for us. I don't know what kind of God you've been introduced to. Maybe like Dario, you grew up or you had an experience with a parent or something or some guardian who just really hurt you. So you kind of like pasted their character onto God. Or you've allowed the secularists and the angry atheists out there to convince you that God hates people and God is some kind of misogynistic jerk in heaven. And these people who disbelieve in this God really have a problem with him for someone who's not real, in their opinion. What kind of God do you believe in? The God of the Bible looks like Jesus. And Jesus doesn't just see people in need, he feels. When it says in verse 36, look what it says. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion. The word compassion is translated in another translation as he was moved with compassion. In other words, that something stirred inside of him when he saw other people in need. Something moved in him. The word actually for compassion in Greek literally cannot be translated into a single English word. It refers to that gut level reaction that stirs down deep inside of you when you see something that should not be. Like last year when we saw the Syrian refugees crisis, you know, break out, and then there was that picture of the boy, the little boy on the shore who had died and washed up. And if you were like me, you saw that picture and something happened here. It was just evil. There's evil in this world. Or a couple of months ago when we saw the little boy from Aleppo, this face covered in dirt and blood, sitting broken, and you see it and something happens here. You see, that little thing that happens here, I think, is the greatest proof that there is a God in the universe. It tells us it should not be. See, people usually take those bad things that happen to people and say, there can't be a God. And I say, well, why do you have a problem with it? Because if there is no God, then it does not matter. But because there is a God, it does. and it stirs us and it moves us. And the heart of Jesus is for people who are far from him. That's the God of the Bible. That's the God that you may have missed growing up or may have misunderstood growing up. He's the God who goes after the lost sheep. He's the God who goes running to the lost prodigal son who's covered in pig slop. He's the God who chases the sinners and the prostitutes and the alcoholics and the cocaine addicts and the materialistic superficial moms and the selfie addicts and says, stop finding fulfillment in things that will let you down and find your joy in me. That's the God of the Bible, the God who wants you in his home. A couple of years ago, my son who's four, a couple of years ago when he's two, I went through this bad period as a father where I would wake up in the middle of the night, like every night, and get filled with fear about my kids. And so I would wake up, I couldn't sleep until I went upstairs, checked on their beds and checked on in their rooms and saw that they were safe. This is like for like 4 months. And I've told this story before, but it bears repeating. And one night, it was like a hot summer night, and I remember I got up and I went into the first room, and there was my son, my older son, sleeping in the second room, my daughter was sleeping, and then I went downstairs to where my baby boy was sleeping, and he wasn't there. It's like 3 a.m. How many know you're not really truly cognizant at 3 a.m., no matter how awake you think you are? So I'm starting to like, okay, where is he? So I go to my wife's side of the bed, because maybe he's on the other side of the bed with my wife, so he's not there. And sometimes she would get up and put him on the couch when he came to our bed at night, so I go to the couch, he's not there. And it's a summer night, so I'm thinking, did he go outside? I go outside, check the pool. Like, that's going through my head. Now I'm looking at the pool, is he in there? God help me, no. And my heart is pounding. Pounding, 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 3 a.m. I'm like barely awake. I'm just stressed and worried about my children. And I start running through the house everywhere that I could possibly imagine. Where is this child? I can't find him. I go back upstairs to my daughter's bedroom and I look again and I go over to the other side of the bed. And I didn't see that sleeping on her side, back to back, snuggled up in a little ball, was my baby Jake. And my heart just went, ah. So I went back to my bed, and as I'm going back to my bed, the Holy Spirit, which has my full and complete attention at this moment, speaks and says, Tim, do you see how you felt when your child was missing? That's exactly how I feel about every person who does not yet know me. I don't know what kind of God you grew up believing in, but that's the kind of God that I see in Jesus. He doesn't just see, he feels. His heart beats for you. He wants you in his family. Number three, open your mouth to pray what Jesus prays. Open your mouth to pray what Jesus prays. So what do we pray for? Like, your prayers reveal the content of your heart. Your prayers reveal the idols, in some cases, of your heart. Whenever you're consistently saying, God, I really, 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 really need this. It's just, maybe you don't need it. Maybe you just convince yourself that you need it and that you're not fulfilled until you have it. Maybe that's the case. Like, praying for what? I don't know. Significant other. Praying for what? More money. Praying for what? A bigger house. Praying for what? To move. A better job. What is it? Maybe you don't need it. So what about praying what Jesus actually says to pray for? Here's what he says in verse 37. He said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray, verse 38, therefore pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his vineyard, into his harvest. So what does Jesus say to pray for? Pray for people to go. Pray for people to go. Here's my prayer for you, Waters Church. Go. This is why we're planting churches. This is why we're doing Compassion Weekend. Not just to be excited that people are coming to our church, but to say, thank you for coming, now go. God, give us a going church, a church that knows how to go and do. Not just come and listen, but go and serve, go and help, go and clothe and love and care and do the things that Jesus actually told us to do. Not find the perfect church, not find a great church, but be the church and love the people that God's heart beats for. We got to pray the prayers that Jesus told us to pray. In 2 weeks, we're going to start our first series in this building, and the series is on prayer. House of prayer. That's what this is. Pray according to God's word. What does it mean? What does it look like? Come back and hear and be a part of that, because we've got to be a praying church that calls out to God, send heaven here to earth. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Where? On earth. As it is where? In heaven. In other words, the prayers of God are not, get me out of here. The prayers of a Christian is not, God, this world could go to hell, just save me. The prayers of the Christian is not, I just can't wait until Jesus comes and gets us out of this mess. No, the prayers of a Christian are, God, this world needs you. So I pray that your kingdom comes and your will is done here on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, let it start with me as I go. And I do what Jesus tells us to do. So I see this passage here where Jesus says, okay, this is what I want you to pray for. And I see the disciples like, okay, that's what we'll pray for. So I just see them like, okay, Lord, we pray. Jesus just told us to do this, Lord. So we're praying that you send someone out into the harvest field. Just send someone. Anyone, Lord. Okay, is that good, Jesus? Have we done that? And then look exactly the next thing that happens, verse 5 of chapter 10. Then Jesus sent out the 12. And then it says, he says, go. Go heal the sick. Go raise the dead. Go cleanse the lepers. Go cast it. You receive. Now give. Isn't it amazing that he tells them to pray for people to go, and then he tells them, who he told to pray, to be the ones to go? Isn't that cool? Which is telling us this. Many times, the answer to our prayers is us. I had one of you come up to me after service a couple of weeks ago when I preached about being the church. And this person said, would the church be willing to help someone in desperate need? I said, yeah. This person said, well, we have a person in our small group who needs an appliance, and they're going through a hard time. They can't afford it, so would the church be... I said, okay, let me just ask you a question. Do you think that all the other members of the small group can afford to buy the person an appliance? This person said, yes. I said, go do it. That's the church being the church. So we don't need to start an appliance buying ministry. Get you to sign up at InfoSet. Go sign up for our appliance buy. No, see a need and meet it. Find a hurt and heal it in Jesus' name. That's the church being the church. Going out there and doing it. Being the answer to your own prayers. In this Compassion Weekend, I'm not asking you to pray about it. You understand, you don't need to pray about the things that Jesus tells you to do. Love your neighbors, you love yourself. Well, let me pray about that. Tithe, give your money away. Well, let me pray about that. Right? Get involved at your local church, changing your community for the goodness of Jesus. Well... let me pray. I'm busy taking selfies. Right? Don't need to pray about this. Do it. Number four, finally, open your hand to give what Jesus has given. Man, the day that some of you learn to let go of your money, it's going to change your life. My wife and I have a rule with Compassion International. I've sponsored children since I was 15 years old. It was $20 back then. Now it's $38 a month. And the rule in our house is we will always sponsor more children than we have cell phones in our home. So we've already picked up a packet because my son's getting a cell phone next week. Don't tell him, by the way. I think that's a rule every family in America can absolutely afford to do. We think nothing of getting ourselves something else. We'll pay $75 for jeans in a heartbeat. Boom, no problem. They're nice jeans. Shoes, $60. Of course. And by the way, do it. I love nice jeans, as you can see. I love nice shoes. But let go of your money to bless somebody else other than you. Because the vortex is real. And if you're not careful, you get so sucked up into it, you'll lose your very soul. Let it go. Some of you don't tithe. Tithing is like, I call tithing the training wheels of giving. The first 10% in, out, back to the house of God. And then on top of that, Cheryl and I give to compassion, give to other things. Every time we add another child, more blessings come in. You can't outgive God, friend. You can't outgive God. This church is here in this building. Do you know why? Because in 2013, we decided to tithe as a church. Tithe is 1/10. So every dime that comes in, a penny goes out. Every dollar, a dime. Every hundred, a 10. Every thousand, a hundred goes out. And we are here, I believe, because of that decision 3 years ago to open our hand to give what Jesus has given. Now listen, when you do it, it's like ripples in a pond. We heard a powerful story. I want to close with one more story. I want to show you a guy that we met down in El Salvador up on the screen. His name is Emmanuel. Emmanuel was our tour guide on the second day of our visit to the country. Emmanuel was 5 years old when his mother died and his father turned to alcohol to heal the pain. He became a raging alcoholic. And in every other imagination, Emmanuel was headed down a path of despair and poverty and destruction. But someone brought him to church where there was a compassion program started up because someone 35 years ago was sitting in a church just like this, hearing a message just like this, walked out the door, picked up a packet, sponsored a child, and the child's name was Emmanuel, 35 years ago. He got into the program. He came to Christ. He begged his father to come to church for 2 years. His father refused. Finally, after 2 years of pleading with his father comes to church. His father comes to Christ. All his older brothers come after his father gets saved. All his older brothers come to Christ. His father brings his brothers, his father's brothers, to church. All his brothers, all his uncles come to Christ. His entire biological family is one to Christ because someone like you was sitting in a room like this listening to a guy like me, and they left and they sponsored a child. And today, Emmanuel lives in El Salvador. He's an engineer. He's successful professionally. He's a pastor of his church, and he oversees 20 compassion centers in the country of El Salvador. Because someone took a packet 35 years ago. His life is being changed. His villages are being changed. His family has been changed. His nation is being changed because of someone like you. Open your hand. Open your heart. Open your eyes. Change the world. Stand with me, please. Father, I pray that these words will not just be words. I pray that these words will not just be words. They will be action. May your kingdom come, and may your will be done on this earth as it's done in heaven through us. In Jesus' name, amen. One last thing I want to let you know. The center is up and running that we paid for. It's up and running, 153 children. Your sponsorship money pays half of their registration to be a part of it. If they're not sponsored, they can't go. So they need to be sponsored. Now, also, we understand fully, Haiti is in serious problems. Haiti is in serious trouble, okay? Because we tithe on what you tithe, whether or not you tithe, we tithe on it. This past week, we were able to send Haiti $10,000 to Compassion in their Haiti program. That's the church being the church. So understand that. We're not here just to be happy about a big building. We're here to bless the world. Help us do it. Sponsor a child. God bless you.